Our first speaker is going to be Dimitrios Kotsonikolas, who's an assistant professor at the CSE department at the University of Buffalo. His research interests are broadly in experimental wireless networking and mobile computing with a focus on millimeter wave LANs. And he's going to present our first and last paper. So the first paper is on multi-stream beam training for millimeter wave MIMO.
I'm Dimitrios Kotsonikolas. This is joint work with Yasaman, Kumail, and Edward from Rice University and Carlos Cordeiro from Intel. The title of the talk is Multi-Stream Beam Training for Millimeter Wave MIMO Networks. Okay, so legacy MIMO, right? We send multiple data streams to multiple clients simultaneously over the same frequency band in order to increase the system throughput. This works only if we have orthogonal or semi-orthogonal channels among different clients. Now, this is fine in the sub-6 gigahertz band, right? We're privileged with a rich scattering environment, which means that we can get semi-orthogonal channels and high multiplexing gain between almost any group of users. The situation is different in the millimeter wave case. So first of all, as I mentioned before, right, the upcoming .11AY standard allows for single-user MIMO and multi-user MIMO for the downlink case only with up to 8 streams. Now, what is different here? Well, first, in the millimeter wave case, as people said before, you can pack many antenna elements right into one phased array, but you cannot have the same number of RF chains. You cannot have one RF chain connected to one antenna element due to cost, size, processing constraints. So what you end up doing is that you have one RF chain connected to one phased array. Like here, K RF chains here, each of them connected to a different phased array. Now, in addition to the different architecture, you have also different channels, and the previous two speakers explained this a lot, right? We have a few dominant paths only, so sparse channel, and we have high path loss, which means we need analog beam steering to achieve communication. So the analog beam steering now becomes a critical factor here, right? It impacts the effective channel because, as you can see in this picture, right, the choice of analog beam can amplify some of the dominant paths, can attenuate some others, can completely eliminate some others, right? So eventually, the effective channel between the access point and a given client depends on the selection of analog beams on the two sides. And finally, the analog beam configuration is a key player here that determines the SNR at each client and the channel correlations among a group of users, clients, which in turn determines the multiplexing gain. So, in this work, we refer to MIMO beam steering as the selection of analog beams on the access point and a group of clients. The idea is that analog beam steering should avoid common paths, which would cause throughput degradation due to high channel correlation and interstream interference. And the goal, essentially, is to efficiently steer millimeter wave beams over diverse or ideally orthogonal paths to reduce these undesired channel correlations. Now, if we have perfect narrow beam, regular shape, right, non-overlapping beams, the problem is rather easy, right? You can see in this example, these two beams most likely will capture two different paths, so no correlation, everything is fine. But as the previous paper showed also, in reality, at least today, phased arrays do not create those nice beams. They create beams that look like this. And in this case, the problem becomes complicated because even if you get high SNR from a beam, you don't know how many paths it captures and which paths it captures. So in this work, we propose MUTE, multi-stream beam training for millimeter wave networks. MUTE tries to identify dominant paths between the access point and each client by leveraging millimeter wave characteristics. At a high level, we propose here to repurpose the mandatory sector sweeps that happen in millimeter wave wireless LANs. Basically, again, the access point performs a sector sweep, trying each directional beam wider, while the other side listens in quasi-omni mode, and then the same procedure is repeated on the other side, right? And those sector sweep frames are known frames, so if we correlate the measured beam pattern with the known pattern, we can get the power delay profile for each beam. And by leveraging the gigahertz sampling rate and the channel sparsity, we can get pretty accurate, we can get power delay profiles with high resolution. So how do we use this beam-specific PDB. Let me show a toy example here, which I will be using in the rest of the talk. So in this case, we have three dominant paths, right? One line of sight path and two reflected paths. And as we can see, the blue beam, beam M, captures two paths, right, one and three, but it does not capture path two because path two falls in a null for that beam, right? And similarly, the red beam, beam N, captures paths two and one, but it does not capture path three here. So I'm showing also here the aggregate power delay profile that shows all three paths. Now, a key observation here is that a common path across two beams is reflected as peaks in the beam-specific PDBs that have almost the same delay. So by comparing beam-specific PDBs, we can infer whether those two beams capture similar or diverse or orthogonal paths. Okay, how do we use this information? The problem here is that once you try to apply this approach to different clients, well, you are having a challenge, right? The challenge is that PDB shows relative time delays with respect to the shortest path, and you have ambiguity across different users because there is no common time reference. So instead of common time reference, we use the access point as a common reference point in space. So mute infers path direction, angle of arrival or angle of departure, by coupling PDP measurements for specific beams with known radiation patterns. And the assumption here is that even though antenna arrays, phased arrays, create irregular beam patterns, you can still know the beam pattern, right? Because it's a deterministic function of the codebook and the antenna spacing. So let's continue with the same toy example and see here how we can infer the direction of path one. So we use here a scoring metric. We start with the assumption that any possible angle is equally possible, any angle is equally possible for that path. And here for simplicity, I'm using a 5-scale discrete metric. In the paper, we have a continuous metric. So now, the goal is to infer the direction of this path one. So we will check the power delay profile of each beam one by one. So we can see here that beam one does not capture path one. So this suggests that the angle of path one is unlikely to lie in the high directivity regions of this beam, right? So if I calculate the average directivity given by this red circle, right, then it is unlikely that path one is in these angles or these angles, because otherwise it would have been captured by beam one. So I penalize those angles by lowering their score. Same for beam two. Beam two does not capture path two either. So for this angle and this angle that correspond to high directivity regions of beam two, I again penalize them by further lowering the score. Now beam three is different. Here beam three captures path one, so it is likely that the angle of path one lies in one of the two high directivity regions of beam three, so I increase the score, and eventually I repeat this for all the beams, right, and for all the angles, and I end up with a score for each possible angle, right? So here we can see that the highest score corresponds to this angle, which is indeed the angle for path one, right? And of course, how accurately you can do that depends on the beam patterns, on the beam width, on how overlapping the beams are, and on the resolution with which you know the gain for each angle. So now, once we get the direction for each path, along with the knowledge of the beam patterns, we select beams over a diverse or ideally orthogonal set of paths for multi-stream transmission. So here I'm showing the formulation. In the paper we have some examples. So I want to select a candidate set of beams for user U, which is part of a group of users G, okay? So I will consider each dominant path for that user, and the goal is to select a beam that has high directivity gain along the dominant path of that user, and at the same time minimizes the directivity along all the dominant paths of all the other users. So let me summarize what we have done so far. Okay, we start with those periodic beam sweeps that are part of the standard. We leverage channel sparsity and gigahertz sampling rate, perform autocorrelation, and get per beam delay profile. Then we use this scoring metric to infer the direction of each beam, And finally, we select a candidate set of beams for the access point and each user. And the last step here is a local search, right, where we have to test each of the possible configurations of those candidate sets. And why do we need this local search? Finally, this is because eventually, right, you need to find out which configuration gives you the higher multiplexing gain. Now remember, all our measurements include direction to omnidirectional transmissions, right? We have never done any direction-to-direction transmission so far, so you need to set all the possible combinations, right, out of this candidate set to find the one that gives you the highest aggregate rate. Okay, so for the evaluation, we used here a test bed that we have at UB called X60. It uses millimeter wave transceivers from National Instruments with 2 gigahertz bandwidth, user-configurable 24-element phased arrays with realistic codebook beam patterns, 25 beams, 3D beam patterns. Now, the problem is this platform doesn't support MIMO, so what we ended up doing is emulations. We collected traces for single user transmissions, and then we used those traces to emulate MIMO. So we compare with 2 benchmarking algorithms. One is exhaustive search, try all possible beam combinations, right? This is not practical because of the high search overhead, but it gives us an upper bound to performance. The other algorithm is SNR-based beam selection, where basically you select a candidate set based on high SNR. The rationale is that high SNR will give you a lot of margin to deal with interference, with interstream interference. So I will show here one example only. In this case, we have the access point here. We consider a 2x2 MIMO case. User 1 is here, and we change the location for user 2. And I'm showing here the aggregate fire rate for each location for user 2. For comparison, the baseline scheme and mute use the same candidate set size. So I'm grouping the results per row, and you can see that for each row, the baseline scheme gives you at most 60% of the exhaustive search, and in particular, in those 3 locations, 4, 7, and 10, the performance is very poor. This is because, in this case, both user 1 and user 2 have the same line of sight, right, and most likely, SNR-based selection selects beams that capture the same path and result in high correlation. Okay, in contrast, mute gives us here 90% of the total rate that we can achieve with exhaustive search. So I will finish with one question. Could zero forcing help here? Zero forcing digital precoding is a known technique, right, in the sub-6 gigahertz band to deal with interstream interference. So the question is, can it compensate for a poor selection of analog beams? So let's see here an example. We consider again the same locations, 2x2 single user MIMO in this case. The x-axis is the number of candidate beams, same, we assume same beams on the access point and the user. And we show the normalized aggregate fire rate again, with and without zero forcing. So let me focus on this figure. We see here 2 regions. In this region, we see that even without zero forcing, the SNR-based beam selection can give you pretty good results, at least 80% and more of the max of the max. Zero forcing gives you limited gain, but the cost here is the high search overhead. You have to try too many beams to find the best configuration. The practical case is here, where we can see that zero forcing indeed can boost performance, but both schemes with and without zero forcing, eventually the performance drops as the number of tested beams decreases, right? And for comparison, remember, mute is here. Mute uses an average of 4 beams only and gives you 90% of the max performance possible, right? So without zero forcing, you would need 16 beams on each side, so 16 to the power of 4 combinations to achieve similar performance. With zero forcing, you can drop this number to 10. This is still much more than 4. Okay, so the conclusion is that zero forcing can help, of course, right, but it cannot fully compensate for a poor selection of analog beams. So let me summarize. Multi-stream analog beam steering is the key player in millimeter wave MIMO networks. In this paper, we presented mute for efficient multi-stream beam training. Mute takes advantage of channel sparsity, gigahertz sampling rate, and the known RF codebook beam patterns to identify dominant paths on the access point and clients and steer the beams so that it achieves highly orthogonal or semi-orthogonal channels, right? And we show that it achieves, on average, 90% of the maximum possible aggregate rate. Thanks.
So our second presenter is John Palacios. He's a PhD student in IMDA Networks Madrid, Spain. His research interests lie in millimeter wave communications, including beam training, analog digital beamforming, and localization. So he's going to talk about adaptive codebook optimization for beam training on off-the-shelf 802.11ad devices. So John.
So hello, I'm John, and I'm here to present this work on adaptive codebook optimization for beam training on off-the-shelf IEEE 802.11ad devices. So applications such as virtual reality and high-definition video streaming demand for wireless multi-gigabit per second throughput for best user experience. Millimeter wave is a technology that satisfies this requirement, achieving gigabit per second throughput over wireless communication. This communication band comes with the constraints of mandatory directionality over constrained hardware capabilities. That doesn't allow us to apply the classical beamforming techniques for MIMO. So in this presentation, I will talk about how to make use of this millimeter wave directionality to increase the throughput at the bit rate up to 150% by making use of the channel estimation through simple SNR measurements. And we will do all this using only commercial off-the-shelf devices. The presentation flow will be as follows. So first, I will explain how the standard does the beamforming. Then, I will describe the hardware capabilities in terms of beamforming and standard requirements. After that, we will see how the channel characteristics affect the received signal. And at that point, we will be able to develop step-by-step our method ACO, adaptive codebook optimization, in order to make channel estimation possible and use it to adapt to this channel. Finally, we will show the obtained results of this method against the standard. So let's begin with the standard. Ideally, we would like to have directional communications towards the other device. And this communication is achieved, it should be achieved, through an array factor, an array antenna. So on these devices, the Talon 7200AD, the array antenna consists of 32 antenna elements connected through phase shifters and a switch to an analog beamforming structure. So what 11AD does is, the following ping-pong algorithm. So the access point starts transmitting beam patterns. It starts transmitting pilot signals over beam patterns. The depicted beam patterns here are the ones measured from the Talon rotor. And together with each beam pattern, it appends to the pilot signal its ID. So when the station repeats this process, it appends the strongest beam pattern ID. So after this process, the access point already know the strongest ID for communication, both for access point and station, and simply needs to use its already selected for communication beam pattern to tell the station which beam pattern it should use. So here comes the problem with this. First of all, using a fixed codebook for beam training and communication, this constriction, it only allows you to select the optimal beam pattern among a finite set of beam patterns. The ones in your codebook, which is not the optimal for communication. And secondly, the use of irregular beam patterns is way far from optimal, and is not scalable to more complex scenarios. So ideally, what we would like to do is to design some beam patterns such that if we measure them, we can use these measures to reconstruct an estimation of the channel and build a beam pattern in order to adapt to it for more directionality, better gain. By following these three simple steps, we can easily design a method to outperform the standard 11AD, since this one only compares beam patterns and select the best one among them. So why does this method does not exist yet? They already talked about this before, but I remember. So the problem comes from how to translate the measurements to a channel estimation. So many works have been proposed in the literature, assuming the channel to be given, the radiation properties to be known, or the measurements to be phase coherent among them with perfect synchronization. And these are three techniques that with the actual hardware existing on commercial devices are not feasible. So they are impractical for implementation. And this is why nowadays the standard is using a brute force algorithm that simply checks different beam patterns, compares them, and selects the best one, well, the strongest one. So first of all, to make the channel estimation, we need to know what is feasible to the routers. So we check this talon router, and the hardware has the basic beamforming capabilities. This is for each antenna, we can switch on and off the power and decide among four different phase phase shift values. We can, in this hardware, in this device, define a codebook of up to 64 antenna, 64 beam patterns for the beam training, and the standard requires on the receiver side to be able to measure SNR and RSSI. So what we will do will be to design our custom measurement beam patterns such that when we feed them, when we feed them back the measurements of RSSI and SNR, we can reconstruct an estimation of the channel. So let's see now how the channel behaves. For simplification, we will assume only two antennas on the device for now. So here we have some waves, waves that we would receive. These waves, signals that we would receive on the receiver, are simplified to be sine waves. And if you feel more comfortable with the phase notation, this one is depicted on the right side. And the waves we are showing here are the following one. The blue line corresponds to the wave we would see, the signal we would see when the transmitter at the receiver, when the transmitter is only using the first antenna element of the antenna array. The second one, the green one, corresponds, is analogous, the same one, but for the second antenna element. And the red one is the interaction of both when both antenna elements are transmitting. But note here that we can do more than just switching on and off antennas. We can also change the phase shift. So what happens if we change the phase shift of the second antenna? Okay, so here, by modifying the phase shift of the second antenna, we also modify the kind of interaction between the both waves, ranging on amplitude from destructive to constructive interaction, creating different amplitudes. So the core of this work is discovering that the square of these amplitudes lays on a sinusoid function. So by measuring the beam patterns corresponding to these four possible combinations, we can reconstruct this sign. And inside this sign, we can find encoded the amplitude and the phase of the antennas. So we can use this thing to rebuild the channel. So far, we can make the channel estimation for two antenna elements, using one of the antenna elements as reference, the first one, as it's not moving. We skipped a lot of math during this for that you can find in the paper, but this is not enough for the purpose we want, as we want to use as many antennas as possible. So what you will actually find in the paper is how to extend this idea in order to use a whole beam pattern as reference for the phase shift and how to do it for as many antennas as we want. Now, we are entering the beamforming now that we already can estimate the channel. So beamforming can be simplified to deciding which antennas to switch off and on and with which phase shifts. So the first thing to decide is how many antennas and which antennas are gonna be on. So we're gonna make a little assumption, and it's assuming that after the phase shifting, the interaction of the waves produced by these antennas on the receiver side is gonna be constructive. As if it's not, we can always modify the phase shift of these antennas to make it constructive. So under this assumption, it's obvious that the antennas that are gonna be on are the one that with the highest power received in the receiver, the most powerful ones. So we're gonna switch on the most powerful ones. And the power received when we switch on n antennas, the n most powerful antennas, is this expression. It's given by this expression. So the number of antennas we are going to take is the one that maximizes this expression. As for the phase shift, we're going to simply cancel the channel effect on each antenna using the phase shifter. So the received wave at the, from each of the antennas is going to have phase zero, or almost zero, as the hardware is constrained for to have to a quantized phase value. So we're going to just round it. Now, one may say that applying this to each antenna, since we saw that not all antennas are on, is unnecessary overhead. So the solution to this is quite simple. You don't want to estimate the channel for every antenna. You don't do it. You simply do a subset of antennas and estimate for that one. But when we do this, another problem rises, and is that we are discarding a set of antennas that are like, they are not there. They are invisible. So we came with this idea. We are going to divide antennas into two sets, the active ones and the inactive ones. And the active ones are going to be the ones we want to use for communication, as saw in the previous slide. And the inactive ones, well, the ones we don't want to use. And at each iteration step, we are going to estimate the channel for the active ones, and not only for the active ones, but from some another subset of the inactive ones that we're going to call the exploring antennas. We will select some random antennas from the inactive one in order to be computed to have the channel estimated also for them. So at each iteration, we are going to update the inactive and active set of antennas to include the strongest antennas in the active one, the one we use for communication. So this may sound a bit complex, so here's an example. Each of these symbols represents an antenna element of the antenna array. And as we already mentioned, there are some of them that are going to be stronger than others. So we will represent them as big antennas. This may be caused because they are in the front, they are in the back, they have better directivity in the direction of the channel, or simply because they have constructive instead of destructive path interaction on those antennas. So now we're going to switch them on and off. We're going to set the active and inactive sets of antennas. The active one is represented in green, and the active one is green, and the inactive one is represented as black. And now at each step, we select some random antennas from the inactive set. These are the exploring antennas. And we compute the channel for both the green and the purple antennas. So at the end, when we compare them, only the strongest ones survive to this process. Does it work? Yeah. After iterations, you can see that we will only keep the strongest antennas for the communication. So now it's time to see how method performs in real world. We implemented everything on these already mentioned devices, the Talon 7200AD, and tested the algorithm on the place where I work. This is an open office area scenario. The access point was mounted in the ceiling. It's a 3D scenario, while the stations were on the desk, we moved the desk. And we have three different areas in this scenario, so most of cases are covered. This is a line of sight with desks, a line of sight without desk, and non-line of sight behind the wall. And we're going to measure the performance in terms of SNR and its corresponding bit rate. So let's move to the results. This is an overview of the results. Here you can see the average of SNR and bit rate for the standard AD and our method, ACO, and for both uplink and downlink. We can appreciate here a significant gain of 4.5 dB for the SNR that translates into an average gain of 50% bit rate increase. So going case by case in this scenario, we see first of all that the SNR gains go up to more than 500%, and it has quite a geometrical behavior. So the gain is quite dependent on the position. This is probably mostly caused by the fact that fixing a codebook for communication creates some blind spots in the direction. So there are some directions that are better covered by the beam patterns defined in this codebook, which allows our method, since it doesn't have this problem, to easily outperform the standard. These gain ratios translate into bit rate, especially on the areas with less coverage. So to conclude, I will summarize the function of our method and obtain results of it. So we design a method to get channel information from simple SNR measurements, use this channel information to improve communication, decrease the overhead of the method through antenna element probing, and implemented this everything on commercial off-the-shelf devices. The results are a significant gain in SNR of around 4.5 dB that translates into 50% in average for bitrate. If you actually want to see this working, we are running a demo in WinTech this Friday. We will be showing the method performance live, the measured channel, transmitted beam pattern, and SNR performance. Thank you very much for attending this presentation.
So our next speaker is going to continue this train of millimeter wave beamforming and better coverage. Our next speaker is Sanjib Sur. He's a new assistant professor at the University of South Carolina and joined this fall. He received his PhD in computer engineering from Wisconsin-Madison. His research interests are in millimeter wave and sub-terahertz networks. And he's going to talk to us today about scalable millimeter wave networks. All right. Thank you, Sanjib.
Thanks, Warren. Hello, everyone. I'm going to present our work towards scalable and ubiquitous millimeter wave wireless networks. This is a joint work with Shinyu, Yanis, and Kyuhan. The majority of my research works, including this one, are really motivated by the fact that the global demand for wireless data is skyrocketing. Right after the commercial launch of LTE, demand for wireless data has increased 20 times in just 5 years. And industry's prediction is that this will continue nearly 10 times in the next 5 years and possibly 100 times in the next 10 years. Now, this is really not surprising. We are witnessing a massive surge of smart connected devices every day, with some of the emerging devices and applications stressing the wireless network extremely. For example, an immersive virtual and augmented reality application demand 5 to 6 gigabits per second wireless speed with sub 10 millisecond frame transmission latency. Another critical application is your autonomous car. At a peak rate, a self-driving car can generate as much as 10 gigabits per second data locally, and even if you're offloading 10% of it to the edge, you still need a gigabits per second reliable connection. Now, demand from these use cases, in fact, led to the formation of a group called IMT 2020. International Mobile Telecommunication Unit, IMT, back in the year 2014, came up with a vision. What should be the minimum capability of radios in the year 2020? Well, it should support at least 20 gigabits per second peak capacity. The network should be able to serve 1 million devices per square kilometer. Of course, not from a single base station, but from several small and pico cells. But more importantly, the radio should be able to achieve less than a millisecond, a sub-millisecond latency for critical mobile application. And all the buzz about new 5G radios that you hear today, they are just trying to catch up with this vision. By the way, this is not an exhaustive list. There are quite a few others. But in the interest of talk today, I'm going to focus only on throughput and latency. So where are we right now? Well, existing LTE and Wi-Fi alone will be unlikely to handle this kind of demand. But as you have seen from the last two presentations, we do have a new technology called millimeter wave technology that works on this huge unlicensed spectrum. To give you a visual perspective, this is how much we use today at LTE and Wi-Fi. And compare that with how much we have at millimeter wave. Between 30 to 300 gigahertz, we have 1,000 times open unlicensed spectrum. In fact, commercial device just using a small 2 gigahertz slice out of it already can achieve 7 gigabits per second. So achieving that 20 gigabits per second should be easier with millimeter wave. But the challenge is with this sub-millisecond critical latency. Because you see, millimeter wave, because it operates at very high frequency, it has two key challenges. The first one is a link adaptation. The radios has to use this tiny pack of several antennas to focus all its energy towards one direction by creating a beam. And aligning the beam, recovering the link during mobility is a challenge, and it takes a long time. That's not the end of the story. Even after you have aligned the beam perfectly, there might not be possible millimeter wave connection because of blockage. Your own body, building, different objects can kill the link connection. But as long as you can switch the data connection seamlessly to nearby base station, we should be able to get a ubiquitous connection. But the challenge is achieving a millisecond level coordination between such base stations. So throughout the rest of the talk, what I'm going to do is go through each of these challenges and what we did to solve them. So first, take a look at the link adaptation part. As I mentioned before, millimeter wave device has to use this beamforming to create connection. And recovering the link, aligning the beam takes a long time. In fact, existing measurement had shown it takes 10 to even 1,000 milliseconds for a link to recover during mobility, even for 64 beams. Of course, when the base station is far away, you have to create narrower beams so that it goes longer range, but narrower beams means you have to search more. So imagine scaling that 64 beam all the way up to 1,024 beams. How do we do that? And still get a sub-millisecond critical latency? Well, for that, what we propose is a fast beam alignment based on the observation that millimeter wave channel is sparse and mostly dependent on line of sight path. So let me explain what I mean by that. When wireless signal travels through the environment, it follows a line of sight direction, antenna to antenna, bounces from several reflectors in your environment, and arrive at the receiver side with a tiny bit of delay because the path lengths are potentially different. Now, if we are to measure the signal amplitude across these different paths, this is what it looks like. Notice that the entire signal space is sparse and mostly dependent on this sharp peak, which is at the line of sight direction, and the tiny bump that you're seeing here is coming from a very strong reflector. But more importantly, when the device is mobile, there is no guarantee that you will be able to find those strong reflectors in the environment. So mostly it will depend on line of sight path. Now, when a beam is perfectly aligned with the line of sight direction, the resulting throughput can be very high. In fact, commercial device can go more than 2 gigabits per second today. But a tiny misalignment like this, if I were to measure the signal amplitude in this condition, the signal amplitude will drop. The beam's performance drops from multiple gigabits per second to a couple of hundred megabits per second. But the key point to notice here is, depending on how much the beam is aligned with the line of sight direction, you can model and track the best beam without searching through the entire space. And that's how our fast beam algorithm works. But how do we figure out this line of sight dominant path without searching through the entire space? Well, let me explain to you with this example. Consider at this point, you have two measurements available from two different beams in a link. And if you measure their beam's channel, this is how their response will look like. Notice that each of these response can be modeled as an impulse function, where this theta is the direction of the path, and A is the amplitude of the path. B1 theta is the gain of beam 1 towards that direction, and B2 theta is gain of beam 2 towards that direction, same path. So how do we find this unknown direction and amplitude from this two measurement? Well, you can formulate it as an optimization problem, essentially trying to minimize the difference between what we measure versus what we model. But what about multiple dominant path? For example, scenarios like this when there is a reflector prism. Of course, if you measure the beam's channel under this condition, you'll see each of these response has potentially two impulses coming from two different paths. And you can model each of these impulses again from and put in the same optimization to find the unknown direction and amplitude for each of these paths separately. But as you can see, as we have more number of paths, you have more number of unknown variables to solve, so you need more measurements. So how many measurements do we really need to find all dominant paths? Well, fortunately, as I mentioned before, the channel at millimeter wave is sparse. The signal can only propagate from 2 to 3 directions. In other words, it doesn't matter if you have 10, 100, 1,000, or even 1,000,000 different beam directions, the signal can only travel 2 to 3 directions. There exists a sort of an upper bound on the number of paths in the millimeter wave channel. And what we are interested in for each of these paths, solving these 4 unknown variables, amplitude, or gain of the path, azimuth and elevation direction, and the phase of the path. So 4 variables per one path, so you need a 4K measurements to find all dominant path, in other words, find the best beam. So look what we have done here. What we are essentially claiming is the number of measurement it takes for beams to align does not depend on the number of beams in a device. In other words, it can scale well for any arbitrary number of beam direction. And now this is a pretty strong claim. So how does it perform? Well, we did some tests to understand the performance of our algorithm based on SNR loss, signal-to-noise ratio loss. Ideally, a lower signal-to-noise ratio loss means our algorithm performs better on a commercial off-the-shelf test bed with 64 different beam directions. The plot you are seeing here is x-axis shows the signal-to-noise ratio loss from our algorithm, and the y-axis shows the cumulative distribution function across different experimental setups. So this is how the result looks like. So let me explain the result a bit. On median, our algorithm achieves less than 1.5 dB, which is quite accurate. But if you look at 90th percentile SNR loss, it can be as high as 4 dB SNR loss. Now, 4 dB may not sound a lot to you guys, but when you have a millimeter wave link, even a 2 dB SNR loss means multiple gigabits per second throughput loss. So what can we do? Well, what we empirically verified is you can do additional refinement on top of this 4K measurements to, and we identified that at most 8 extra measurements can give you a SNR loss within a 1 dB in 90th percentile case. We did simulation 2 to understand how it scales beyond 1024 beams, and I would encourage you to take a look at our paper for more results and insights. Now, this fast beam alignment also translates into latency gain. This table shows 3 different schemes. The leftmost column shows different beam directions. We have IEEE 802.11ad, a standard beam alignment protocol, performs really poor, takes more than 700 milliseconds for a beam to align for 1,000 different beam directions. Compressed sensing works relatively better, but compressed sensing does not work on a commercial platform because it needs accurate phase tracking, which is not available at millimeter wave. Compared to that, our algorithm achieves fast beam alignment with less than 0.5 millisecond, 300 microseconds to be precise, for a device even with 1,000 different beam directions. Now, recall that there is no guarantee you will be able to sustain millimeter wave connection even if you have aligned the beam perfectly because of blockage. So the idea is as long as you can seamlessly transfer or hand over your mobile device from one base station to another, we should be able to get a ubiquitous connectivity. Fortunately, in a future millimeter wave network, these base stations are supposed to be tightly connected with a backhaul, either via a wired connection or a dedicated fixed millimeter wave wireless connection. So you can forward the data from one base station to another as you hand it off. The challenge is each of these base stations can possibly support hundreds of beam directions. So before you can figure out which base station is the best to get connected with, you have to potentially search for all the beams for all the base stations. That's not scalable. So what can we do? Well, for that, what we propose is called a predictive device switch. So let me explain this example. Consider at this time, you have 2 base stations to choose from, and your millimeter mobile device is connected to the one of it. At this point, we have to make a decision whether the second base station is better than the first one. In other words, if you somehow know this angle from second base station, we will know how the beam looks like, and then we can make a decision between two base stations. But how do we figure out this angle without connecting to the second base station? Well, because the mobile device is connected to the first one, you already know the distance and the angle information. And these two base stations are part of the infrastructure, so you know the relative geometrical arrangement between them. So all we have to do is plug in these two unknown variables in your well-known triangle equation to find the unknown directions from the second base station. Of course, this representation is in 2D format. You have to actually solve it from a three-dimensional case. But you can extend this for any number of base stations that are visible nearby. So what we have essentially done is using just one device's channel information, extrapolating how the channel information is supposed to look like from other base stations. Now, of course, this does not take care of the fact that there could be blockage from other base stations too. But for that, I would encourage you to take a look at our paper of what we exactly did to solve. I'll quickly show one of the results from fast device switching. So this plot shows on the x-axis the number of available millimeter wave device you have in your vicinity. It varies from 4 to 10. 10 means very high dense deployment of base station. The y-axis shows is after running our algorithm, how many of those base stations we needed to search to get connected to the best one. This is what the result shows. Notice that even if a mobile device has 10 different base stations to get connected with, we needed to only search for up to 3 base stations to get connected to the best one. In other words, we have about 3x faster device switching time. But more importantly, we are kind of creating a sort of upper bound on the latency it takes for device cooperation. So, to summarize the talk, wide spectrum at millimeter wave enables very high throughput, ultra-low latency connectivity. But blockage and beam alignment are the key barriers for mass adoption, and you need optimization across link protocol and system stack for scalable deployment. The system that we proposed achieves sub-millisecond beam alignment latency at millimeter wave with sub-10 millisecond device cooperation, and it runs in real time with standard compliant manner. So with that, I'd like to stop here, and I'll be very happy to take any further questions from you. Thank you.
So now hold your horses, because we have one more presentation from Dimitrios, which will be our final presentation on using LED lights for millimeter wave beam steering, and over to Dimitrios.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is still in millimeter wave, but totally different topic. Here we are talking about single user case, no MIMO. Same group of authors, different first author. So the idea, before Sanjeev presented a way to basically choose beams, right, in a very fast way, here I'm going to show another way to do this beam steering without doing any measurements in the millimeter wave band. So I'm going to skip the introduction, right? I mean, we saw this before. Okay, there is this overhead of beam steering that we try to minimize, right? And the overhead becomes worse once you have mobility, right? Again, you have translation motion or rotation motion, everything becomes misaligned, and if the user keeps moving, eventually it might be the case that you end up training continuously your beams, and the training time might even exceed the time for packet transmission, so then you cannot really get a benefit of gigabit rates, right? So, again, there are many ways to reduce this overhead, and we saw before one. Here we're proposing a completely different approach. The idea is to track devices via light. So more specifically, we want to repurpose the LEDs co-located with the APs antennas, right, which are used for notifications, do some modifications, for example, use pulse width modulation to increase the range of that LED, of the intensity, and then if you do that, basically you can convert those LEDs to fixed light anchors on the access point. And as the user moves around, right, you can keep tracking the location of the access point and the line of sight direction from the access point to the user using light measurements. So how does this work? Well, here we leverage the fact that the two bands, millimeter wave and light, have similar characteristics, right? They both have a dominant line of sight channel, and they both have limited scattering and multipath, and sparse, which results in a sparse channel. So now, what we propose is to do out-of-band tracking of the light line of sight path, right? We use light measurements to calculate the 3D angle of arrival of the line of sight, which allows us to do 3D beam steering. And we require absolutely no measurements in the millimeter wave band for the client side. And if you acquire the line of sight direction, then the steering principle is simple. You select the sector of the beam that maximizes the directivity gain along the line of sight. So the light steer protocol has two phases. Phase one is at the beginning at the association time, when you want to associate to an access point. In this case, the access point will do a sector sweep, right, to allow the client to discover it. But the client will select on its own side a beam just using light measurements. Then we move to beam steering. And in this case, the client starts moving now after association, and while it moves, it doesn't have to perform any measurements in the millimeter wave band. It can keep receiving light measurements, right, and track the access point and adapt its beam without even notifying the access point. So we require here zero in-band measurements on the client side and zero feedback to the access point. Of course, it might be the case that adaptation on the client side only is not enough to maintain gigabits bit rates, right? The access point might also have to, at some point, to switch beam. And in that case, we have here, again, a solution that leverages the periodic beacon sweeps by the access point, which allows us to basically do just one sector level sweep for all the clients, followed by a polling phase where each client reports the best beam for itself, right? And going back to the protocol, this can keep going on forever until the link breaks. It is possible that some blockage event will cause the line of sight to be lost, and in that case, we have to go back to association, and even the client, sometimes it might have to do a beam sweep if there is no line of sight to associate to find another reflected path to the access point. So the challenge here now is how to estimate angle of arrival using light. To present the picture, here is a light source, here is a light sensor, okay, and we can see that the light intensity on the sensor depends on three factors: the distance between the two, the source and the sensor, the irradiance angle, and the angle of arrival, which is what we want to calculate. Now, the challenge here is that light intensity from LEDs or common light bulbs is incoherent, and the common off-the-shelf light sensors don't measure the phase. They measure only the amplitude of the intensity, right? So we cannot use techniques like music, which have been extensively used in RF localization to calculate angle of arrival. Instead, what we propose here is to utilize a sensor array with known relative angles. For example, we can place six sensors on the six faces of a mobile device. Also, we assume here that the device size, if the device is far from the access point, then the device size is much smaller than the distance to the access point, which allows us to approximate it as a point in space. And in this case, the irradiance angle to each sensor and the distance between each sensor and the access point is the same, which means that essentially the intensity, the light intensity at the sensor only depends on the angle of arrival, and that's because sensors have different orientations. So then we can see that the ratio of the intensities at any two sensors is just a function of the angle of arrival, and we can do some simple math and calculate the angle of arrival as the ratio of light intensity. This approach can be extended. In the 3D case, we show the details in the paper, so you can calculate both the azimuth and the elevation component of a 3D angle if you have, you know, the light intensity ratios in three planes perpendicular to each other. And as I mentioned here, even though you need just three sensors, we put six sensors to maximize coverage, right? Because it is possible that as you hold the device, you might cover some of these sensors. So for the implementation, we used a test bed that has both millimeter wave and light bands. For the light band, we used the custom sensor array that you can see here, and different light sources. The results in the paper use visible light. Recently, Kumail did some measurements with infrared also. I don't have results for infrared. For the millimeter wave band, we use two different platforms. One is the Vubic front end that connects to a WARP baseband. here we used narrow beam horn antennas, 7-degree beam width, perfect cone shape, no side lobes, no back lobes, no overlapping patterns. Okay, we want to see how LIST performs with such almost perfect beams. But as I mentioned before, in reality, devices use antenna arrays and they don't get those perfect beam shaped beam shapes. They get irregular beam patterns. So again, we used X60 also to perform an evaluation with antenna arrays. And we did experiments in different buildings. Here is one example topology where basically to emulate translation, we took measurements along these four lines in all these locations. And in some of these locations, we also rotated the device. So the first result I want to show is how accurate is this angle of arrival estimation using light. Here I compare the angle of arrival inferred by the light sensor array to the ground truth that we can obtain with geometry. We consider all possible positions and orientations. We show the CDF of the angle of arrival estimation error, and we can see that for 75% of the cases, the error is within 3 degrees. And actually, if you use horn antennas then, the narrow beam horn antennas with this angle of arrival estimation, we found that 70% of the cases, you end up selecting the best sector, right? The highest signal strength. In the remaining 30% of the cases, you choose one adjacent sector to the best one. But the result might be different with imperfect beams. So this is an example of the beam shapes generated by the X60 testbed, 3D pattern and 2D pattern, where you can see that you have really very wide beams, side lobes to make things worse. Also, the beams are overlapping with each other. And these are patterns not only in the X60 testbed, these are similar patterns you see in commercial off-the-shelf devices today. So here we want, first of all, to answer the question, does this assumption, this hypothesis of the dominant line of sight still hold true? So I'm showing here, right, I'm comparing the signal strength when I select beam using LIST versus the signal strength when I do exhaustive search, and I show the SNR loss between the two cases. And we can see that the line of sight assumption holds true only for 30% of the cases, right? Only in 30% of the cases, LIST selects the maximal strength beam, which incurs zero loss. In all other cases, you have some loss. Now, the good news is that in 80% of the cases, the loss is within 1.5 dB of the best case, of the best beam, right? Which means that you can still maintain strong links without really doing exhaustive search all the time. Also, we observe here again that the same error, the same loss is achieved whether you use LIST, angle of arrival estimation, or whether you know really the ground truth from geometry. And eventually, we found that typically this method results in 2 to 3 selects up to 3 adjacent beams from the maximal beam, right? So if you want to improve the performance even more, you can do a local search, right, which is also part of the standard, right? You can test a few beams around the beam that you selected to try to improve performance better. So we also did simulations here to see how the system scaled with multiple clients. We considered backlogged clients, uplink traffic, random waypoint mobility model. We compare against the baseline 8.11. Both schemes use the same rate adaptation algorithm based on SNR. And for 8.11 AD, we use sector level sweep every time the rate drops below the basic rate of 385 megabps, below MCS1. So the first graph here shows the overhead. The y-axis shows the percentage of overhead, basically the fraction of time when the protocol exchanges control messages over the total simulation time. So we see that base 8.11 incurs high overhead even for a single client, 5% of overhead, because in case of mobility, it resorts to sector level sweep again and again, and the overhead increases a lot for a large number of clients due to contention. In contrast, LIST maintains almost constant overhead regardless of the number of clients. Remember, we have zero overhead on the client side, and one sector sweep followed by a polling phase on the access point side, regardless of the number of clients. So now the difference in overhead is reflected, of course, in the throughput, right? So here we compare, we show the normalized throughput with respect to an oracle that selects always the best beam combination. And we can see that the baseline scheme cannot get more than 60%, right? Lie-Steve achieves 75 to 80% and 1.6 to 2x gain over 802.11 AD. We have many more results in the paper. I will stop here and just summarize. So we presented Lie-Steer that performs angle of arrival estimation with off-the-shelf light sensors by repurposing the LEDs and notification LEDs on the access points. We perform client-side beam steering solely based on light measurements, zero in-band measurements, and we also have a scalable design that allows the access point to train with multiple clients using just one sector-level sweep by repurposing, again, the periodic sector-level sweeps, beams that the access point has to transmit anyway. We evaluated using a test bed that combines a light VLC and a millimeter wave platform, and also we augmented the evaluation using MATLAB simulations, and the key results, 2.5 degree average angle of arrival estimation error, SNR loss within 1.5 dB for 80% of the cases, even with wide beam irregular pattern phased arrays, and 1.5 to 2 times throughput improvement in wireless LANs because of the reduction in overhead. So I will stop here.